So I'm Nadisha, I'm a senior technical lead at WSO2, and my topic for today is transforming your business via APIs. Okay, I think Shevan actually talked about this slide earlier. So API now accounts for about 15% of internet's traffic. McKinsey in 2017 estimated that $1 trillion is up for grabs through redistribution of income through APIs. And some studies have found out that certain organizations, 25% of certain organizations' revenue flow through APIs. So this kind of shows you how significant that APIs are becoming in the IT industry, as well as on traditional industries who wants to transform their businesses into API-driven businesses. So for those who are from a non-technical background, APIs might be a new term. So APIs are essentially an encapsulation of your intellectual property. You would have different kinds of assets in the organization. These could include your processes, these could include your services, your data. You need to have a way of exposing them out for your external consumers. You would have your third-party applications, your partners who come as B2B interactions. You would have your web portals, mobile apps, cloud apps, so many different types of consumers who wants to use these internal assets of your organization. So APIs would be kind of the vessel or the channel through which they can come in and consume those assets or processes or services or data, whatever it is that you have within the organization. Okay, so why APIs? This is a common question that comes into the picture. We talk a lot about APIs. Why do we actually need APIs? One of the most prominent case for APIs is that it actually creates a new channel through which you can expose your services to wide variety of customers or consumers in an effective manner. So this is one of the primary reasons why APIs are important. And it, from a technical standpoint, it actually gives you a standard way of communicating between applications, data, and services. And from a customer point of view, this APIs allows you to build a tailored customer experience on top of your existing business assets to improve the overall customer experience. So Rana earlier in his talk talked about ecosystems, how banks want to move from an omni-channel service delivery to an ecosystem kind of service delivery. So building a tailored customer experience would be part of that journey. If you talk about what actually drives the need for APIs, the primary requirement is that, or primary need comes from the explosion in the number of connected devices. When you talk about connected devices, you have mobile phones, tablets, and now you see connected fridges, connected toasters, connected coffee machines. So that actually brings the need to have a more robust system where each component or the system or the service can communicate with each other. From a business point of view, there is a need to integrate the value chain. You would see partners or company wants to integrate their internal systems with partners, with their suppliers, with their logistics providers, with their couriers. So all that has to be also part of this drive that actually allow an organization or that pushes and organizations to move to an API-driven world. And from a consumer point of view, there is a rise in consumers who are empowered by technology and who demand organizations to provide more connected experience for them. So in essence, organizations have understood that the audience is much bigger than what they think it is, and they need to have a proper way of providing services to this newly found audience, and that is provided through APIs. If you summarize what drives the need for APIs, it's no longer about company owning an asset. It's about how that asset can be made available to their consumers when, where, and how they want it. So if you really talk about from a business perspective, APIs provide opportunity to scale the business without physically expanding. So you don't need to have new shop fronts, new staff for sales. APIs kind of allows you to grow your business without having all of that. It allows you to reach to customer segments who are unreachable or who you could not reach before. And it also allows a channel through which indirect sales can be made via third-party apps. A good example would be Uber. Uber has its own APIs that exposes to third-party apps. So if I want to go from here to, say, Marina Bay, I would check on Google Maps. It gives me multiple options, transit options, and then it also gives me an ad which says, this is how much it will cost me if I take a Uber. So that is enabled through an API that is exposed from Uber. And that is kind of indirect sales method for Uber to drive customers to their app. So the million-dollar question is, do APIs solve everything? Having a proper, having an API ecosystem, does it actually solve all your organization problems? Yes, it actually caters to a lot of opportunities, or it brings up a lot of opportunities, but also it creates certain concerns for businesses and technical folks who are within the organization. From a business standpoint, it actually creates a question of how should we expose the APIs in a standard way? Should we expose it through SOAP? Should we expose it to REST? So these concerns has to be addressed by a business, from a business point of view, or whether I provide a file interface, or all this has to be sorted from a business point of view before you go and expose the APIs. Security is critical, because you are exposing your internal data, your processes to external parties, so you need to have a proper way of securing your APIs. Organizations that depend on revenue to be generated from APIs would want to track and monetize the usage, so there should be a way to do that. Organizations want people to adopt your API. So it's one thing to have the APIs available. It's another thing to get people to come and use those APIs. So you need to have a proper way in place or proper mechanism in place so that external application developers can come in, find the APIs, should be able to subscribe to them, try it out, and integrate with the application. So you need to build that proper ecosystem for people to come and adopt your APIs. And finally, from an internal stakeholder point of view, you need to have a proper way to publish and manage your APIs. You should empower your internal developers to create APIs in the first place. So all that has to be driven before you have a proper API interfaces or proper API ecosystem in place. And from a technical standpoint, the primary concern is security. How am I going to make sure that only authorized people are going to access my APIs? That's a primary concern, and that should be addressed before you open up your APIs. From a management point of view, you need to have a proper way to push changes. Your APIs always evolve, so you might have API on day one, and that has to evolve with the business needs. So you need to have a proper way that you push your changes out to your consumers. From a reliability standpoint, you need to make sure that your API platform is reliable. How would you make sure that it is reliable, highly available? And once the traffic picks up, you need to have a proper mechanism to scale your deployment to ensure that you are able to cater large volumes of traffic that are coming through your APIs. So what's the solution that you can provide to all these problems? API management is one way of solving this problem. API management provides you a mechanism to secure APIs primarily. It allows a system through which you can easily manage your APIs. It provides a mechanism for you or for your application developers to come in and make the adoption process much smoother. It provides the way to increase or have a reliable system and make sure that it is highly available. you have a mechanism through which you can monitor and monetize the usage of APIs. I will talk about each of these circles in detail in my next few slides. So from an API, from the concept of API management, it's about exposing all your APIs through a centralized gateway or a set of centralized gateways. There should be an API management system provides a way of enforcing access control again via this API gateway. The solution should be able to easily design, publish APIs for your API developers so that your internal teams are empowered to push more and more APIs to outside consumers. It allows a mechanism through which external application developers can come in and easily discover what APIs you have, try them out before you integrate with the application. API management system also provides you the capability of ensuring reliability, high availability, and backward compatibility of your APIs. And most importantly, you are capable of understanding the trends, usage, and have the capability of monetizing your APIs if you want to do, if you want to earn some revenue out of the APIs that are exposed through your platform. So WSO2 has its own API management solution, which is a componentized solution. I think Dakshita spoke briefly about this solution that we have. So we do have a gateway component, which is the entry point for all the traffic to the API manager. Your internal application developers can, your internal API developers can use the publisher interface to create and manage your APIs. So it has a capability of managing the lifecycle of APIs, versioning it, making sure that your APIs are backward compatible. The gateway is linked to a key management server that does authentication and authorization. There's a traffic manager component which can do throttling, rate limiting of your APIs. And then all the usage information is pushed to the analytics engine that can do real time as well as batch analytics. And when it comes to your app, when it comes to the application developers who wants to use your APIs, there's a developer portal available for them to access and see what are the APIs available, and then try them out through the developer portal, and then finally adopt APIs within the application. So I'll talk about the capabilities that are provided by the API management solution. The primary is primary capability is API security. So once you have your APIs available, it is important to make sure that your APIs are not accessed in an ad hoc manner. You should know who's accessing them. The people who are accessing them should have proper should be governed through authorization and authentication to ensure that they have the right permission to access your resources. So that's the primary concern. And then you want to make sure that your processes and systems are not overused by your API consumers. So if you allow external traffic to come in, you need to have a proper way of ensuring that the requests are throttled so that your internal systems are not affected by the traffic that comes through through the API path to your internal systems. So how do we ensure that security is governed? So we have a single point of entry for all the traffic. You would have an API gateway that fronts all the incoming traffic. API gateway becomes the policy enforcement point for all the API traffic that comes through. And then if previously, if backend handles authentication and authorization, you can pass it on to the gateway to ensure that gateway handles the authentication and authorization, freeing up your backend resources of the overhead of doing the authentication and authorization in the backend. So this is what it would look like if I put it as components. So you would have different third parties coming in and consuming your APIs through the gateway. And then gateway exposes all the backend capabilities to these consumers. From a deployment standpoint, The gateway can be a single gateway or set of micro gateways that exposes the capabilities, the backend capabilities to your service consumers. And this entire layer can be made high available and fault tolerant to make sure that your APIs become highly available and keeps running even if a single gateway or single microservice or micro gateway goes down. So another important capability through the gateway is that it also provides some level of caching, so that if you have static backend services that provides a static response, your gateway can cache them to provide better or faster responses without creating an overhead to your backend systems. API security, I talked a lot about API security. So the API management solution has inbuilt API security capabilities. It has inbuilt OAuth2 as well as JWT-based authentication. Authorization of APIs can be based on resources as well as roles. The API gateway has the capability of extending the authorization mechanism to a SACML-based entitlement engine that allows you to do attribute-based authentication or attribute-based authorization. So for example, if you want to limit the usage of an API to a given time, say if you want your API to be accessed from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., you can define it as attribute and control authorize or control the access to that API only during that given time using a SACML entitlement policy. So from a component point of view, this is how it interacts. So your gateway, API gateway, receives all the requests. It acts as the policy enforcement point, and it talks to a key management server, which is a OAuth policy decision point for key validation. From a performance point of view, all these key validation decisions can be cached at the gateway to improve the performance. So that the same key received by the API gateway will not need to be validated against the key manager each and every time. So the third aspect of API security is how you throttle and rate limit your API usage. In the WSO2 API manager, the usage control is based on a subscription. So you would have multi levels of subscription for different users. You might have a premium user who would have a premium plan. You would have a trial user who has a constrained API usage plan for them. Throttling has two aspects to it. You could do throttling for a large amount of requests, and then you can also do burst control to ensure that a premium user will not be exposing your consuming your APIs in a burst at any given time during their subscription. So usage control can be enforced based on the number of requests, or if it is a bandwidth driven service, you can also control usage based on kilobytes or megabytes, basically based on a bandwidth. There is also a mechanism built in to ensure that your backend is protected. So irrespective of how many subscriptions you have, you can define a hard limit to your backend to ensure that your API traffic does not exceed that hard limit, irrespective of how many people are going to consume. Even though they might be within the subscription window, the hard limit will ensure that your backend is protected irrespective of how many people will actually consume them. So how throttling and rate limiting works is that the same architecture, we would have an API gateway which actually pushes all the events to a traffic manager. Traffic manager will, based on the rules that are deployed on the traffic manager, policies that are deployed on the traffic manager, will make the decision and put it on a decision topic which will be available to all the API gateways that are going to be in the deployment. Traffic management policies can be added by an administrator. There's a UI that is available for you to create your own policies and then deploy to this traffic management server. So now we talk about ease of management. You might have a large development team who wants to create and publish APIs to this ecosystem. There's a user interface that is available for you to create APIs. And we also provide Swagger-based API documentation where you can create a Swagger and you can use that Swagger to create an API definition in the API manager. So a Swagger-based approach is also supported. And once the API is created, there is a life cycle attached to API. You can publish your API to the gateway. You have the option of creating a new version, deprecating the API, retiring the API, or even blocking the API as and when required. As the APIs evolve, you have the option of versioning these APIs. And once you create a new version, you can make the old version as deprecated so that new subscriptions are not allowed to the older version, but existing subscribers can still use that API. So those capabilities are inbuilt with the product. And then all these capabilities are exposed as APIs itself so that you can programmatically create and publish APIs to the gateway through the API management server. And then there's first class support for API first development methodology. So you don't, so if you are developing a new capability, you don't need to have a backend available. You can create mock service responses from the API manager itself as JavaScripts and expose them to your app developers, while subsequently your internal developers can start working on creating the backend services. So once your backend services are available, you would also have your application developers would also have the apps built so that can significantly cut down the time to market of your product when it comes, and it actually makes the adoption process much smoother for your application developers. Okay, so when talk about adoption, we do provide an API portal for you to discover and subscribe to APIs. All the APIs are listed in this portal. You can attach documentation, usage instructions to your APIs. The API portal also automatically creates SDKs for commonly used languages so that it allows the adoption process much easier. And then from a user point of view, I can go in and try this API out before I integrate with my application. So I can try out the API, see what request, how the request should be sent to the API, what is the response that I get, how the API actually behaves before I go in and actually program my application to call this API out. So these are some of the examples that we have of actual customers who have used our API management solution to create their own custom portals. These are some of the public portals. We have a lot of our customers using this as for their internal portals, for their internal dev teams to discover the APIs that are available within the organization. So if you talk about availability and reliability, it is important to make sure that the system is highly available and fault tolerant. You should ensure that you eliminate any single point of failures, and to ensure that your deployment becomes flexible and adhere, or you can deploy in multiple deployment zones. So we have patterns that we've defined. So onto your left is the simplest deployment pattern where you have all the components bundled together and deployed on as a HA deployment. Onto your right is a more complex distributed deployment which is capable of having an external gateway deployment to cater to external traffic, while there's an internal gateway deployment to cater internal traffic. You would have high available key managers, high available portal, publisher, and traffic manager as well. So you can, this, so left is the most simplest, right is one of the most complex. So there's multiple other patterns that sits in between so that you are flexible to choose which patterns suit you the best. So from a monitoring and monetization standpoint, all API traffic is captured and pushed to our analytics engine. These statistics are processed, or this data is processed into statistics and are made available to both API consumers and publishers, which allows you to understand the usage patterns of your APIs. You are able to monitor your service availability, trigger alerts. So for example, you could say that for a given service, if my average latency is 50 milliseconds, but if it exceeds more than 50 milliseconds, you should send an alert to a system admin who's in charge of the platform. So that kind of alerting mechanism can be built into the solution to ensure that your services run smoothly. And then you have the option of monetizing the API usage. Given the fact that you have all the statistics available, you can you have the option of using that statistics to generate a bill. You can also link to a third-party monetization engine where you can do a prepaid billing plan where you can put your credit card and make a subscription first before you start consuming the APIs. So these are some of the stats that are available from the API manager. For the stats vary from different types of users. The stats you see as a publisher is different to the set of stats that are available for API subscribers, and they kind of cater different needs of those groups. Okay, I'll quickly talk about a case study. This is from one of one of the largest apparel manufacturers in South Asia, which operates in which has manufacturing facilities in 17 odd countries and employs close to 100,000 people around the world. This company has been in existence for about 30 years. They were catering to large-scale apparel brands, but the margins were very thin when it comes to large-scale manufacturing or large-scale apparel brands. So they were running on volumes. So they wanted to try out a new business model, cater their product to small and medium brands. These are the ones that operate that only has an e-commerce front. And then they wanted to provide the services to these small to medium apparel brands. So what they did was they created what they call the integrated logistics platform that allows different types of e-commerce platforms like Shopify, Magento, or Amazon stores to connect. So they had an API interface available which can be consumed by these storefronts. So I, as an end customer, would go to one of the store e-commerce sites, purchase a pair of pants. The order goes to the integrated logistics platform. They figure out which is the closest third-party warehouse which has the pant that I want, and then make the order there, or reserve the order there. And then they send the order details to a courier who delivers in my region to pick the order up from the given warehouse and ship it to me at the earliest possible time. So this is an apparel manufacturer who wants to also build a solution in the logistics business or get into the logistics business. So this is for them, it's about creating more value to their customers and tapping a market which they could not tap before. They were never into this SME market, but now they are capable of capturing that SME customers through this particular solution. And this has been in operation close to 1.5 years. They've seen success to this, success on this model, and now they want to expand this and provide this capability to large brands like Nike, Levi's, who also has storefronts, and then try to use the same platform to allow those to provide a similar service to those large brands as well. So everything is connected through APIs, and they are able to achieve this kind of or venture into this kind of business through APIs. Okay, that concludes my presentation.